thing, but a thing we want you to tune into every Saturday at 4 o'clock. This is Saturday, February the 4th, 2017, and this is our 148th show, meaning that we have been here at least 147 shows before today. And I want to say that last week, we had a show that I was, you know, just privileged to watch with our Vice President Harold Lamar and members of Morocco Coleman Rock and Ron Ali. It was a great show and a presentation about books that's written by veterans and members of this chapter. So it was a good show. Both books, I think, I would recommend that everybody read Coming Full Circle with Morocco Coleman and this In Search of Justice and Truth and Injustice by Ron Ali. Naturally, my book was also discussed, Short Change, you know, Memoirs of an American Combat Veteran, which chronics post-traumatic stress disorder and Agent Orange, and then we deal with the VA claim process. Today, we are here after being off a week and back, and we are going to talk about some things that need to be talked about right now. We see the president making all kinds of executive orders, and he is, you know, causing all kind of, you know, people being upset everywhere all across the country. We got protests and all kind of stuff going. Coke cases going against him already, and he's fined people. Ain't been in office 30 days, the first 100 days of the new Trump administration. Now, I mean, I'm of the mindset that, you know, whoever is the elected president represents all the people. And I'm convinced that Donald Trump represents us as veterans. And he did make some promises that I have been tweeting and emailing him to keep. He said he was going to fix VA. We got 460,000 cases of claims and backlog at VA. This has pushed claims back in the traditional claim process. Almost 4 years it takes a person to get from beginning to the end of the claim process. Now, the president has did a lot of executive orders, and he, you know, you can say some of them have been ruled unconstitutional by the court, but he's still doing it anyway. And I'm thinking he should take that same pen that he's writing all these other executive orders stopping things and get VA busy with solving this backlog issue. Now, he's issued one executive order that troubles me deeply because it impacts the VA claim process, and that is a freeze on federal hiring. Now, that tells me that we finna go at business. If he's not going to hire any more federal employees to do federal government, then what does that signal to you? That he's getting ready to privatize a lot of the operations of government. And we need to be very careful about privatization of federal government, especially entitlement programs, because your constitutional rights to due process will suffer the consequences of people not doing what they're supposed to do because they are contracted with the government and not as a part of the government. One of the things I'm asking everybody to do is, if you got a claim pending, you are a part of that 460,000 cases in backlog. I want you to get on your computer and go to your U.S. White House website. U.S. White House website. On that website, you can actually tweet or you can actually email the president. And I want everybody that got a case in backlog to ask him, when is he going to fix the VA claim process? He made this promise to us before the election. Now, let me say, this is, you know, for him not to fix the VA claim process and to be talking wall talk and building up the U.S. military, I think is his contradiction. If you're not going to take care of the soldiers that have fought previously, what make the young people think that they're going to be taken care of if they go fight his war now? Mr. Trump, Mr. President, we want you to fix the VA claim process, and we want you to do it now. Because we are talking about veterans, dependents, suffering in a crisis state. Anytime you got somebody that can't work and take care of themselves and their family, that's a crisis in their household. It's a crisis that if it had been any other group in America that was going through this, the way veterans are going through it, there would be a protest everywhere. And talking about, thank you for your service, if that's the thanks I got for my service, you can keep it. I don't want to see veterans homeless. I don't want to see veterans at VA hospital being turned away and going home on their families. And some of them are actually dying because they're not getting the care that they need. 15 Vietnam-era veterans dying every day from exposure to Agent Orange and post-traumatic stress disorder. Another 22 veterans from all eras are committing suicides. Mr. President, this is a crisis for veterans in America. And I'm saying, and I'm asking every veteran that hear my voice today, to get on your website, get on your smartphone, get on whatever you got to get on to tweet, to email this president that have made a promise to veterans that he was going to fix the VA claim process. It's time for it to be done. I want to just have a shout out to one of the people that I'm putting up as the face of the claim backlog, David Billingsley, who is one of my best friends and a previous treasurer, officer of this chapter, has reached that point where his disability has made him in need of aid and attendance care. Right now, David cannot actually feed himself. He cannot walk. This is a man that was in the Rangers in Vietnam. He had a Purple Heart and a Bronze Star. He did 26 years of work at the VA. And now the VA is dragging his case in the backlog. So these are the people that we are talking about, Mr. President. Look at this backlog. Look at the people that's waiting. Look at the people that's in the claim process today. And tell me, how can you think about sending somebody else's son to war when you haven't taken care of the ones that already fought wars? Amen. This is veterans talk. It ain't nothing but a thing, but it's a thing that we're going to keep in your face, and we're going to push every kind of way that we think we need to push. Next week, y'all, got a show for you. A young man that his adopted father was on the first show that we did here, the number one show, the first show we did is Veteran Talk at www.waen. Joseph Wright Jr. was here. That was my brother and one of my best friends. Well, the remarkable part about Joseph Wright is this. He fell in love with this little boy that I used to like to watch him together. They fought like men, you know, like little men. You know, Joseph go get him because he was a challenge, but Joseph loved this little boy. And let me say this. Joseph died before he was able to actually adopt this kid that he wanted to be his son. And his surviving spouse, my sister, that's the Cloretta Scott King of Joseph Wright's life. She made it happen, y'all. And we're going to have this little boy on here who is so smart, so articulate, to talk about VA benefits next week. Y'all got to tune into this because he is a benefactor. Now listen to this. He's a benefactor of VA benefits. When I say benefit, veteran benefits was for the veteran, his family, and the community. Well, Joseph made that true because Taekwon was a member of Joseph's married family. But Joseph adopted this young man, and now that Joseph is gone, this young brother going to get Joseph benefits till he finished college, and he will be able to go to college because of these benefits. And let me tell you something. We might be raising the next Barack. We might be raising the next president of the United States. Y'all got to see this young man. He is a remarkable, I know he's a challenge because, see, he challenged Joseph. I know he challenged Yelwina because Joseph go get him. I'm going to beat him up when I get to him. Ain't no beating up. That was a love fest. But he is a remarkable young man, and he's going to be hosting the show next week, so I want everybody to get ready for this special show. Because see what we're trying to do, this is veterans talk about veteran issues, about the plight of veterans, and about our future. Now, I got something to say to all those young people that's in the U.S. military. They include my grandson, Freeman Harris. I want to take my hats off and salute you. You're doing the right thing. Don't like your commander-in-chief, but I'm proud of all of y'all. And I know you can't say nothing about it. I don't want y'all to say nothing about it because you're up under the military code of conduct. So we know you can't talk, but we can talk for you. And believe this, we are going to keep our eyes on your commander-in-chief. We're not rushing it into anything that he is not willing to send his own into. If he's not willing to suit up and suit his children up and go, he need to thank before he sends somebody else's child. This is veterans talking. Ain't nothing but a thing. But a thing we want you to tune into. Now, when you start talking about the future, I think Joseph thought Taekwon was going to be a Marine. But, if anything, I'm going to talk him into being in the Army. But the remarkable part about watching our children and looking at what we can offer them. And veterans, I'm saying, we are the best trained unit in our community. And we are too kind of laid back. We need to embrace some of these kids that are having a hard time and giving them a better grip on life. You know, I know Taekwon was real young when Joseph passed, but he put something in Taekwon that Taekwon going to have for the rest of his life, a sense of discipline and purpose. And, you know, that's what we need to be giving our children today, a sense of discipline and purpose and a direction that we can, you know, right now one of the biggest problems in our community is black-on-black crime, and that's coming from our young men. Now, up under this new administration, we're going to see that old law and order mentality where the police is pushing to make sure that any disturbance, they're going to lock you up. We're going to see more lockups of young men than we ever seen before. Those that ain't on the job going to be locked up. Because that neo-penal system is there's a new slave system, and we got to keep it in mind. If we don't start doing something with our young people, this system, this administration will. We will see them, we're going to see a lot of whole hog, you know, support of the police and whatever they do under this administration. So we need to keep that in mind. We need to get ready, especially veterans, to get out in our community and interface with our young people in a way that will better equip them for the thing that they got to deal with right now. And let me say this. He's appointing judges, attorney generals, that look at us in a way that people looked at our ancestors. That we ain't got no rights, that they got to respect. And we need to understand that. And we need to teach our young people how to deal with this kind of a mentality that they're going to have to deal with. You know, the school system is going to, you're going to see it become more abrasive. You're going to see people in positions of power becoming more arrogant toward those that don't have it. One of the things that we can look at that's taking place in the city of Atlanta right now, rise up, Falcons. We're ready for y'all to do what you do tomorrow. But let me say this. The communities around the new stadium displacing people that have been in these communities all their lives. The property value is going up so fast that, and the renovations are taking place so fast that the people that live there now won't be able to afford living there when they get through renovating the neighborhoods. So we got to be really careful about how we see things taking place under this new administration, because this is business. This is business in our face. You don't have that many billionaires in your cabinet if you wouldn't plan on doing business, if you wouldn't plan on making some money, because they are not there for the good of the country. They are there for their own purpose. And we can see this already. Look at some of the executive orders that this new president has provoked. Well, he want to repeal Affordable Care Act, which will put 20 million people out of insurance. He has repealed these don't ask, don't tell laws. He want to, put the alternative community back in check. He feel like they done got too far out of hand, so he's changing the laws to get them back in place. Well, you know, he's already stopped immigration based on religion. Next time, he'll be stopping it based on race. you know, religion, race, you know, politics. We are a country that not supposed to discriminate against people based on these issues. What I believe shouldn't be determined by the government, or how I believe shouldn't be determined by the government. I should have the freedom to practice whatever religion I want to practice, as long as I'm not engaging in violence against anybody. And I don't believe, you know, with my experience with Muslims, they are most peaceful people. You know, what we see in the Muslim community, when they what they are classifying as Islamic extremists, are people that are hiding behind Islam the way the Ku Klux hide behind Christianity. You know, we got a lot of people that say they're Christian, but they're throwing a rope up in the tree to hang somebody because they don't like the color of their skin. That's terrorism. You know, so we're going to see Muslims having their Ku Klux, you know, and I consider the extremists that call themselves Muslims, they're no more than the Ku Klux Klans that call themselves Christians. And we got to keep that in mind. We cannot, and you can't tell what a person believes by just asking. I can say, the day I'm a Muslim, tomorrow I can say I'm a Christian. And you can't tell the difference. You can't tell what I believe. So I can't, you shouldn't be discriminate against a person based on what they believe, as long as that belief is not causing them to harm another person. This is Veterans Talk. It ain't nothing but a thing. We had some discussions last week about the VA and how to negotiate or navigate this system. Now, one of the things that we did today at our monthly meeting, we got approved a proposal to seek and secure 50,000 computers to give out to veterans. Now, how would we do that as a small organization? Well, we are actually eligible to get government surplus properties. I discovered that, and we are going after that. And I actually talked with the people down at GSA, and they sent us an application to get these computers. And they're kind of excited about the idea that we want to get these computers and fix them up and give them to disabled veterans, so that they will be better able to access and use the e-benefit system, which is the way VA is doing business. And because we're not in that system, we're not getting our benefits as expeditiously as we should be getting them. Because those people that are in that system, and I got some people that have come testify, they get that stuff through the system much faster. So we have adopted the process of helping veterans do their own claims through e-benefits. Even though I still read all the records that come in before us, I put them on e-benefits. Once we get on e-benefits, the veteran monitors his own case. He actually can go into the system and see where his case at every day. You know, so I think this is going to be a better way. So we're looking forward to getting these computers, and by July, we'll start giving out these computers to veterans. Now, one of the things, one of the criteria for getting the computer, the veteran going to have to be willing to go through a basic usage, computer usage course. In other words, we're going to teach you how to use a computer. Then you're going to have to learn e-benefits. Everybody that gets a rating from VA, whether they get money from it or not, every veteran stuff is already in the computer. And the dependent stuff is already in the computers too, because the dependents stuff become that veteran stuff once the veteran pays. So you can have access to the computer because your pay is also in the computer and it's directed that way. You can go in there, you can get any kind of letter you need. E-benefits is the way VA is going to do business with you. So we want to equip our community to do good business with VA. So we got a proposal passed today, and it's called the Free Computer. Free Computer Benefit Access Project. So we'll be working with some other veteran service organizations and the VA. We're making sure that we get these computers to veterans and get them trained in the usage of these computers so they can better use e-benefits. So we, in the process of advocating for changes in the VA system, we got to also make sure that veterans can utilize the system that's in place now. Because we don't expect that our advocacy is going to make the system change overnight. But you can believe that our advocacy is going to have an impact on the system. And sometimes it has a reverse impact of what we initially expect. To give you a for example, I had a client that I argued his case in October 2016. Actually, the DRO, which is the decision review officer, barred me from representing this client as a representative. And I did, you know, well, I know more about the VA claim process than he does, but I see a guy in the hearing as a witness. Well, I want to say this now. If you can't have a representative, you can always make your representative your witness, and VA cannot deny a veteran a witness in a hearing. So I was able to get in the process, but, you know, and we won the case. Actually, the guy, this was one of them fast turnaround. We was in there in October. In December, they put his money in the bank. Now, they put his money in the bank, and he hadn't even got an opinion. You know, so VA is, you know, and they put his money in the bank, and by not giving him opinion, they didn't give him all of his money. So what happens with that, you only got a certain amount of time you can file a notice of disagreement. You know, in other words, they didn't give me all my money, so I don't care how much you gave me, you didn't give it all to me, and this is the reason why you didn't give it to me. That delays your capacity to respond to the decision if you don't actually have the decision. You know, and most of us, if we get some money in the bank, we might forget about the decision. If you forget about it too long, then you know your case is stuck to where it is. So we want people to understand that we need to learn this system as individuals, and we need to be able to negotiate it, navigate through the system with knowledge of what we're actually doing, because that e-benefit system is the fastest route to getting your claim awarded. It's the fastest route to getting your claim awarded. So this chapter is in the process of making sure that veterans in the city of Atlanta will be able to utilize this, because we're going to give them free computers. But they remember now, we're giving you the free computer with the condition that you got to learn how to operate the computer and use e-benefits as your way of doing business. This is Veterans Talk, and ain't nothing but a thing. Now, we are still talking about the backlog. Now, right now, this chapter have enough cases filed. If the backlog, if Donald Trump cleared up the backlog, that would be over $3 million given to the clients of this chapter in terms of income back and forward, meaning, you know, once you get your income started, it lasts to the day you die. So you have to count, you know, every month you're getting the income. If we help you get the income, that's the way it rolls. Every month you're getting your income to the day you die, or until you get a proposed reduction letter. Now, that's not something that dependents have to worry about. They don't have to ever worry about proposed reduction letters, because that stuff is kind of set in ink, you know, set in stone, because your benefits derive from the death of your spouse, so they don't have that wishy-washy stuff. But something that they do that we need to change, they do not give the surviving spouse full recognition of benefits. I have a problem with that. You know, the law needs to be changed. What the veteran got, the spouse should get.
I totally agree.
So we're going to have to, yeah, we just can't stop with looking at things and saying, oh, well, they got that, that's good. They didn't get the full benefits of his benefits. You know, and we need to not look away from that and, you know, be docile in speaking to those issues, because those benefits impact the household, whether the veteran is alive or deceased. Those benefits was his by virtue of his service and his disability. Now, we kind of winked on letting the VA say, well, you only get 70% of what he was getting. Why? You know, I mean, is somebody going to say why? Why not give the surviving spouse the benefits the veteran earned? It shouldn't be no complicated thing. But that's what happened when Congress decided that they're going to reform something or design something to determine our benefits, and we're not at the table. You know, we're not at the table to say, wait a minute, why we got to cut his benefits because he's deceased? He earned those benefits. Mm-hmm. Those benefits should be transferred as he got them. But we have laid back. We're too laid back with too many issues when it comes down to these benefits. You know, we want them, but we act like somebody's giving us something. We've earned these benefits. It is the service that we run to this country in times when, well, during my time, didn't nobody else want to do it. Wasn't nobody else. Matter of fact, they were leaving the country to keep from doing it. You know, I mean, one of the biggest issues during my time of service is that, you know, people were going to Canada, going everywhere, because they was not going to Vietnam. By no means. And those of us that went, we earned the benefits, and we should not have them cut at the point of death. These are things that we need to learn how to talk about when we're talking with our congressmen. When they come out in the community and be asking us, well, I want to get your vote, I want you to support me. Well, I'm going to support you if you do something that I need you to do. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, look at your benefits, look at veteran benefits, and look at congressional benefits. One term, they take care for the rest of their life. They make the same laws that they made for us. They do one term, they get taken care of for the rest of their life. A veteran can do 20 years and get his stuff cut because of the system design. And we got to understand, this is what's going on. It is a system design that has caused us to lose benefits over the years. And if we're not careful, we're at a point right now that VA is going to be changed whether we want it to or not. Because this president is a businessman. Long veterans have been hollering that they want some changes in VA. Now, the best way to change it for a businessman is to outsource it. And let me tell you something about outsourcing. Once it's outsourced, the accountability is lost. Because if a person is not the government, they just contract with the government, they're not held to the same rules as the government. So, to give you, for example, VA has money to stop homelessness. The criteria is they will help you if you're a single parent with a child. I took a young lady out to VA homeless program at Fort McPherson. The first day we got there, they said, well, yeah, you, your story, yeah, we can help her. But the person that got the money is not here. So you come back tomorrow, they're going to write her a check and she won't lose her place. Got out there the next day. The person was there that had the money. They said, all the money is gone. So this young lady with her child, with a six-year-old child, was rendered homeless. We have to understand now, the person that got the money was not accountable to anybody. They just came out there and said that the money was gone. But if it had been the government, working for the government, they would have had to explain what happened to that money. They would have had to have accountability to show how much they been in and where they put it out at. But that contractor just able to come in and say, we ain't got no more money this year. So we have to be really careful about what we are faced with right now. Yes, I would like to be able to go to a doctor of my choice when I'm sick. But what happens if I go to a doctor of my choice and that doctor's not good enough? The doctor's not a specialist in what I'm suffering from. Well, you know, that doctor gonna treat you anyway because that's the only way they're gonna get paid. They got to treat you. They're not gonna outsource you to a specialist the way VA does now, because VA gonna outsource you to a specialist. If you need a specialist, gee, you got to go to a neurologist. You know, that's a specialist. Now, the VA is sending you to a neurologist because the person you saw was not able to deal with your condition. But now, just imagine, if this person that you saw wasn't going to get paid unless they treated you, you wouldn't have been outsourced. They would have treated you, and they might have mistreated you. You know, they might not have been professionally trained to deal with the condition that you are suffering from. You know, everybody that deals with back issues is not, you know, qualified to do all back issues. You know, so we had to be really careful about this outsourcing of government work, because once it's outsourced, it's no longer responsible to the government. This is veterans talking, ain't never a thing. a thing we are talking about today is the backlog and what is President Trump doing for veterans. Really, he made a promise that made every veteran in the United States stop and say, maybe I will vote for him. If he's going to do this for the VA, maybe I will vote for him. But look at this. He's been in office a little over, not quite a month yet, and he made a lot of movement, but not one of those movements addressed the veteran issue. Except one, the threats to Iran. That's going to cause for a buildup in military personnel. Are they going to overuse the military personnel that they got now, which is spread too thin around the world? You got people right now that's going into these hostile environments back to back because they don't have enough people in the military. They go into Iraq, they stay there, and then they come out, they got to go to Afghanistan. They come out of Afghanistan, they got to go to Kuwait. All of these are hot spots. And all of them are occupied by terrorists, people that might drive their car into the compound to commit suicide and kill whoever is near the car when they go into the compound. So we have to be really careful and vigilant. And then I think it's fair for us to ask the president, why would you be talking war while you ignoring veterans? I mean, it don't make sense to me. How can you actually be talking bully talk where you're going to need the U.S. military, and this president is threatening to use the military in the country? In the country. He was telling the people in Chicago, you better get it together or send in the feds. That's the 82nd Airborne and the 101st. Those are young people, our young people. My grandson is not an airborne yet, but he's in the Army. And it's not remote that they give him an order to go to Chicago to patrol the streets in Chicago, because this president said he's not going to tolerate that violence up there. He told them to get it together, or he's going to send in the feds to get it together. We seen what that meant during the 60s when they sent the 82nd Airborne to Washington, D.C., when they was having riots about the Vietnam War. We saw what that did to Washington, D.C. We saw what that did to the psyche of a lot of people that were serving in the military at that time. The AWOL rate of individuals from Washington, D.C. went sky high. Sky high when they realized that they were serving in a military that was pushing their folks around in that community. You know, we don't want to think about the military policing our communities here in America. The military is not supposed to police our community. That's only when the people are having issues that local authorities can't control. It's a perception that local authorities is not trying to control like they were during the 60s with the civil rights stuff. There's a lot of times local authority was the problem. You know, Bull Connor was the one that was sicking the dogs on the folks. Canada had to send in troops to stop the state from doing what they were doing to black people. But now it looked like what Donald Trump is saying, I'm going to send in the feds to stop black people from doing black people. That's tragic. That's really tragic, because the violence in Chicago is black on black violence. It's not white on black violence. It's not other on black violence. It's black on black violence. And for us to need the feds to come into our communities is to tell us that we done lost control of our communities. You know, and that's something that veterans need to look at, really, because we know what it feels like to be an occupier of other people's homeland. You know, I've been an occupier of other people's homeland. We don't want to see our own people occupied by the U.S. military. So we have to be really vigilant about what this president is saying, what is actually going on in our communities, and how can we as veterans make a difference. Now, I think with getting our benefits, getting that economic flow back into our households and back into our community, to me, is essential. Because Miles said something that I thought was pretty cute back then. I was just a young man when I first heard this, that he who controlled the purse string controls everything. And that was Mao Tse Tung, a communist, and he was talking about capitalism. They was talking about how capitalism controlled everything that the people does. And if you think about it, it does. Because he who controlled the purse string controls everything. If you ain't got no job, you're going to steal to feed yourself and your family. You're going to violate the laws. So they have pushed us in a predicament in our community where we don't have jobs. And the frustration level among our young people is such that they're killing each other as a response to being in a community of lack. You know, it's a community of lack. You know, they lack basically everything, so they're in competition with each other for it. So when they start bringing the drugs in the community, they start killing each other over the drug trafficking. So we need to take a good look at what veterans can do right now in the communities that they live in. Well, one of the things I think we can do is go to the schools more. You know, spend some time in the school system. One of the things that, and I'm going to ask Taekwon about this, how did he feel when he saw Joseph coming up? He know he done cut up, and he know Joseph was coming at him. You know, it makes a difference. It makes a difference when a child knows they got some adult loving parenting, somebody that's going to take care of them and somebody that's going to teach them the right way to go. You know, we just don't have enough of that in our community now because we got too many households with single moms that started having babies when they was too young. And the community has not stepped up and helped these young mothers. So they're being misled by some of the young men that's in their group and you know, they got gangs going on everywhere. The brother was talking about Chicago. He said, like, every ward got a gang. It's a 50th Street gang and the 49th Street gang. So every block got a gang. And they're fighting each other, you know, for the meager charms that come into the community. And we need to understand this. And veteran benefits can change some of this because we can bring more business back to the community. We can afford to do jobs. We can afford to make a difference in our community, and we're too laid back with that. Because we are the only entity in the community that got business benefits. We start a business, the government gonna give us business. We don't even need money to start a business. They will give us money to help start a business. Now, we got to do some credit repair stuff because that's the way they keep us from the benefits. They complain about there are not enough veterans seeking the home loan benefit right now. If you go to the newspaper, you'll see that. But they're not saying that one of the reasons that veterans are not seeking the home loan is because of the credit component. If you got less than a 700 credit score, that benefit is not for you. That's the way the system is now. It used to didn't be like that. When we start taking over and getting in the system, the laws change. Credit stop you from getting your VA business benefits, your VA home loan benefits, and let me tell you something, it's almost going to impact the VA educational benefits. Credit. You know, they got your credit as the determiner of whether or not you get the benefits you already earned. And who got worse credit than the United States of America? You know, think about it. One of the problems that I hear a lot of people, they don't want to deal with the VA because it takes so long to get paid. I don't want to do no business with the VA. It takes too long to get the money. So we as veterans and dependents, it's our VA. It has the function for us. But if we don't engage it and we sit back and let it just roll, you know, just roll away. We got people that love, you know, bless them. They give up on their benefits because they get denied. They give up. Oh, I don't want to deal with that no more. That's too much. It's too much to lose. It's too much to lose. We can't afford to lose these benefits. This is our only economic tightrope right now that we got to pull us up in the community. That's guaranteed. If we use it, The veteran benefits are guaranteed to give us an economic plan for you. You know, but and to tell the truth, one reason they fight us so hard, the average 100% veteran have more income at the end of the day than people that's working. Now, in our community, now that don't mean you get outside our community that it don't happen, but within our community, if you got 100% service-connected veteran, his income or her income is more than most people working in our community. And we're not using it to give our community any uplifting help. That's bothersome to me. When we know that our churches, and we're trying to get the churches to start talking to the young veterans in the pews, how can we help you get your benefits so you can help the community? You know, that should be something that the preachers preach from the pulpit. How many veterans in the pews this morning? You know, I mean, that can increase their tithings. You know, they bring more money to the church house. If they are making money, if they got these benefits, that's why I can't understand why people are not pushing the veterans and their families and in their communities to get these benefits. They don't understand. They just don't understand the economic and social impact that these benefits bring to our community. And we, as veterans, have to make them understand this. If we don't make them understand it, they won't ever understand it. This is veterans talk. It ain't that but a thing. But it's a thing they want to hear. Two of my most loyal supporters are in the audience today. Elwina gonna bring. Elwina, how you doing?
I'm doing fine.
But you, Taekwon, this is Taekwon's mother. You know, this is JD, this is Joseph, a surviving spouse. I mean, she a real soldier. I'm gonna say that. A real soldier, because the average person would have gave up on what she did. So they kept knocking her down. but she didn't give up, because she knew that Joseph wanted this. This is something that Joseph died wanting. He wanted to adopt that little boy. He didn't just want to be around him. He wanted to take care of him. He wanted to look out for him. And he died before he was able to accomplish that. But Elwina understood Joseph's benefits, and she just wasn't going to back up off of it. So we got Taekwon next week. We got this little man that's going to, I'm thinking he's just going to woo the audience because of his smartness. And you know, and when we think about Joseph's love for this little man, you're going to be able to see the necessity that all of us old guys need to adopt somebody. You know? I mean, I'm just saying we need to pass these benefits on, because the ugly part about it, I can talk about this because Joseph, my brother. Joseph had to leave Atlanta, Georgia to get his benefits. He was actually from Roanoke, Virginia. You know, and I tell you, Roanoke, what is that? But anyway, he's from Virginia. He had to go back to Virginia to get his stuff because of the system down here. Now, the same medicals, same guy. You know, I mean, what made Virginia able to do better than Atlanta? This is veterans talk. It ain't nothing but a thing. But it's a thing we want y'all to understand, because these are veterans benefits, not VA benefits, veteran benefits. That means that the veteran has earned the benefits we're talking about. And their family need to make sure that every veteran in their family and every one of them got a benefit. I don't care if he didn't go to out of the state. If he swore himself in, finished a tour of duty, he got benefits. And these benefits can change the way they live. And I want people to think about what we're saying, because this is all we have right now as veterans, especially when you look at the number of homeless veterans in the major cities. Now, you get out in the suburbs, you go to Roanoke, you don't see no homeless veteran. Why? They taking care of that veteran. That's why. They take care of that veteran better. I mean, it don't take a rocket science to understand it. Once we can get that caring system in the major cities where we are, we'll see a different community. You know, we could actually do jobs for people. We could actually start a business and provide jobs in the community to these young people that don't have jobs. One of the things that we're talking about now, we're getting these business licenses for everybody. And Roy got a construction business license. You know, you can go into construction. And he have to get 3% set aside contracts for every level of government. And you know what? Who building more in the city of Atlanta than anybody? Georgia State. I mean, besides private Georgia State, we should be getting some of that business. And they would give it to us if we got a veteran business license. This is veterans talking. Ain't nothing but a thing. Now, let me just pass this off, and then I'm going to... The surviving spouse can get them businesses, too. So Elwina's looking at her business. You know, surviving spouse can get VA benefits to help them with a business. So this year, we're pushing businesses into the community. For those people that already got the benefits, we're finna get the other benefits. We're gonna get them to push it. Because we need these jobs in our community. You know, just think about it. Elwina will be able to provide jobs over there in the community, especially with a car wash. You know, she's gonna be able to provide jobs. Some of them young people over there now that ain't got no income, she's gonna change that. That's what veteran businesses can do in our community. And we got to be bold enough to stand up and do it. We can no longer afford to sit back and say what we can't do. We got to try something different. Let me leave y'all with this. You know, that was a centurion in Luke, Matthews, in Luke and Matthew. But the centurion was a soldier. And he was coming to Jesus because he had one of his men that was sick. And he came to Jesus and asked Jesus to told him the story about his servant being sick. And Jesus asked him, would he heal him? And Jesus said, yeah. And he was going toward his house, and this soldier, and I think about it because he's a killer, just looked at Jesus and said, Lord, I'm not worthy of you coming under my roof. Just speak the word, and I know it will be done. Jesus turned and looked at him and said, no greater faith have I seen than this. And that's all it takes, the faith the size of a mustard seed. We can change where a mountain's at, or where a valley is. You know, we just have to believe that. We just have to believe that we are something special. You know, I think I'm something special. I've survived combat in Vietnam, and what the combat did to me after Vietnam, the streets, the penal system, the business system, and the VA system, right? You know, if you can survive the VA system, you pretty much made it. And I want to say this too. Joseph didn't survive the VA system. And we're not going to let the VA get away with it. We are something that we don't do much of, and what we've been doing it pretty regular lately, is filing a Federal Tort Claim Act. We got one settlement, which I didn't like the settlement, but we got it to the point that VA settled. A winner case is still pending. And I'm gonna tell you this: if it hadn't been a case that had some merit, they could have already denied it. And so we're going to 2017 knowing that this year we're gonna get justice for Joseph Wright Jr. Not just for Tyquan and Elwina, but for Joseph Wright Jr. Because see, I'm gonna tell you this: Joseph had a lot of faith in the VA, in spite of the way it treated him. He believed in it. He wanted to make sure that it did the right thing for veterans. And we want to make sure that it did the right thing for Joseph, because it didn't do him right. And we're going to stick to the fight to the end until we make VA responsible to the people that they're supposed to be responsible to. That's veterans and their dependents. That's the sole role of VA. And we are here to make sure every Saturday that we're talking about the same thing. Might talk about it from a different perspective. And we might have different people talking about it, but it's the same thing. We going to make sense out of this sensitive situation called veterans benefits and VA, the delivery system designed to give us that benefit. Why is it so hard to do? Veterans talk. It ain't nothing but a thing. Hello. G, I thank you for being here, brother. And I'm going to tell you something. You got an interesting case. And the more I think about it, you know, I get to thinking, that's it now. We got to develop this Campbell Jones stuff. And that Campbell Jones stuff, it's got the element in it to get you your benefits in spite of whatever else have occurred. Now, we're gonna get together one more time before I bow, because I want to make sure that we got all the elements together to win this case, and that Camp Lejeune is your key. That's the key that's gonna open this door. We just gotta develop it right now, you know, and that means we might have to go to a president.